All right. Good afternoon, everybody. We are using the microphone because this is also being recorded and live streamed. So even though you're only a few feet away from me, we're going to use the microphone and make sure that we have good coverage on the live stream. So thanks for joining us this afternoon for, I think, what may be one of our first official upper school events, which is like a really exciting and significant milestone. Today's event is happening in part due to the fortunate circumstance that Charley Burkly, who's over here, was in town. And so for those who don't know, Charley is our new college counselor, and she is officially joining us in January. She's finishing up at the university school in Cleveland, Ohio, and she wanted to do right by her seniors. And so she's gonna work with them up through the end of December and make sure that they're well taken care of, and then starting here in January. But she happened to be out here. We were at a conference the last few days, a group of us, something called the Mastery Transcript Consortium. There was a symposium down in San Diego, and so Charley came out to join us for that. And then before she headed back today, she was doing this, which is why it's right now, and then she's actually getting on a flight in just a few hours to head back to Cleveland. Just a quick word about the Mastery Transcript Consortium, which I think some of you may have heard about. We've talked about it off and on, but we were down there with really a host of some of like the top schools across the country. And the conversation, at the heart, it's a conversation about assessment, which may not sound all that interesting to people, but is actually really at the core of the way that schools are designed and have been designed since the early 1900s. And at the heart of this conversation with the Mastery Transcript Consortium is trying to shift from a factory model of schooling, which was really looking at sorting and ranking through grades, to a structure where you're really focused on learning and growth. And so, and when you hear those words, learning and growth, all of you who are Hillbrook parents are like, well, of course, like that's what assessment's about. It's about learning and growth. That's not often true, particularly at the high school level, when you look at the way that grades and those structures play out in the way that students experience school. And so we were part of this conversation. We're very excited to be in a place which is different from most of these other schools, which is that they're trying to like unwind years and years and years of structures, whereas of course we have the opportunity to design this from the ground up. So you'll hear more about this over the next couple of years, but essentially what we're really talking about is creating a structure where you're talking about skills and competencies, and then creating a very open system for students to understand how they're doing against those skills and competencies as that grows over their time. And what was great, well, there was several colleges there, and including the senior admissions person from University of Southern California, and she said two things which I thought were striking. Number one, she said, well, this is also what we're trying to do in higher ed. Like, so it's we're having the same conversation in higher ed, and so, you know, kudos to you and high schools who are having this conversation. And then the second piece is that these types of structures actually help students do a better job of knowing themselves, of growing, and of applying for college. Like, they will actually make them stronger candidates for college. So anyways, it was a great couple of days, and the long short of that is that Charley's with us. One thing I wanted to say before I turn it over to Mike Peller, who's gonna talk a little bit about kind of an overview of the high school and give people a little bit more of a sense of where we are in this process. You know, when we started this conversation 5 years ago, we were wondering, like, what would it look like to start a high school? And very quickly, we came to the conclusion that there was no other high school in this area that looked like the kind of high school that we are trying to design. And so what did that mean to us? So when we looked other places, we did see some schools that we think are similar, or at least in the same realm as us. Castalea, Crystal Springs, Nueva, Woodside Priory, a bunch of schools up the peninsula, up in San Francisco, that do look like us. And what does that mean to look like the school that we're designing? One is they're small by design. And so a school that's small by design has the benefit of making sure that every student is still known and valued. And if you know anything about those schools, it doesn't take away from the opportunity to have an incredibly robust athletic program, arts program, incredibly rigorous academics. You can provide, you find that right size where you're small enough that students are known and where they're really known by their teachers, but you're also large enough that you can have an incredibly dynamic program. So all of those schools have done that, and that's what we expect to do. Second of all, those schools have higher SAT scores, higher, better college placements than the local schools, Catholic or public, in this area. So those schools do better in that space. And then third, and what's most important to me and in my heart, is that those schools don't feel like you have to choose between engagement and meaningful learning and rigorous academics. It's a false choice. You don't have, you can do both of those things. In fact, I would argue that if it's not meaningful and engaging, it's not rigorous academics. And so those three things are things that we expect to have at our high school. And they're things that there is no other high school in this area that looks like that. And so long and short of it is we're here today sharing with you kind of as we start down this pathway, and hopefully a number of your students will join us in this high school. And with that, I'm gonna turn it over to our new head of upper school. We're not so new anymore. You've been here for 2 months. Mike Peller.
Thanks, Mark. So just to extend a little bit on the consortium that we were just at, the Mastery Transcript Consortium, beyond just thinking about how do we assess for learning and how do we create a learning environment, the other reason why this consortium was started in the first place was thinking about what happens with all the really rich, important learning that didn't fit in previous school systems, that wasn't part of the kind of factory model of learn this content and then spit that content back. But if we're a school, and we are, that ask students to reach beyond themselves. And if we're a school that's constantly asking our students the really important question of what matters to you and what are you doing about it, the learning that falls out of that, the really rich learning, the authentic learning, the important and urgent learning that's preparing our students to be ready for college and everything after, that sort of learning is different and unique and requires a different assessment system. And so that's why it was really excited to be in this, because as we design this high school, this is a high school that doesn't yet exist. This type of high school doesn't exist in the South Bay. And in fact, when we think about the whole Bay Area, there are very few schools like us who are positioning our students to be able to be dynamic problem solvers, to step into sort of a new and novel situation and know what to do about it, both because they have the confidence and competence and the cultural understanding and the compassion to be the problem solvers that our world needs. So that's this ambitious project that we're doing, and we're excited to have everyone here ideally be joining us along with this. So a couple things to say, and Mark touched upon this. This is a new high school, but it is the same school. It is the same vision and mission and core values. We will be asking our kids to be kind and curious and take risks and to be their best. We will be asking them to reach beyond themselves. And so sort of the risk nature of a venture is mitigated by a deep history and commitment of this school, of excellent, amazing education that's been happening here since its founding. And what we'll see when you step onto the campus next year is the same school, but with expanded opportunities, with us having the opportunity to use the city as a dynamic classroom where they are positioned in so many places for real authentic learning. I'm gonna touch on this stuff really quickly because I think the big part of today's event is to hear more from Charley and welcome her into the community. A quick plug that Melissa will be talking about, we have a series of webinars that will be happening that are informational both for internal families and external families, and September 29th, I'm gonna go into more depth on this. So this is gonna be sort of fast, but I wanna talk a little bit about the academic program and how there are some similarities that it's consistent with our one school, but an expansion. So first of all, the schedule is a statement of values. We have longer blocks for deeper learning. Classes are only meeting 3 times a week for 80 minutes, which will allow kids to go into kind of rich laboratory experiences, to get off campus for field studies, to engage in dynamic debates. But this time will sort of push back against what too often happens in high schools, which is that frenetic nature of moving from one place to the next without having the opportunity to sink their teeth into stuff that is real. We're going to have these exploratory classes that meet twice a week where students can try something new. These will be ungraded, untranscripted, non-homework bearing, because too often in schools students take on a class because it's what I am good at. It's what I'll get, it's what will make my transcript look great. And what a mistake that is, how limiting that is, how much that prevents students from potentially exploring some idea that might be really beautiful and wonderful for them. Like our lower middle school, we will embrace a differentiated approach to instruction that believes deeply in low floor and no ceiling. And the way that we will encourage and support that is 3 times a week we're going to have these office hours that are both for students who need some additional help, but as well as for that student who the teacher saw, they were so captivated by this. I think if I give them this additional information, it will really nurture that spirit. So both sides of that learning space. And starting from year one, a rich and dynamic and full sports and co-curricular experience. That is a priority and a commitment that we will sort of deliver on, and we'll say more about that in a second. At the 29th event, or anytime you want to have a conversation, we can get more into the program, but this is what a sample ninth grader would take, some integrated math, a biochem sequence, world history, world language, world lit classes, exploratories, and immersives. What are immersives? Immersives are this beautiful extension of our Reach Beyond block that are 3-week courses that use both the city and the world as our classroom. So in ninth grade, in the fall, they will be tackling potential topics like the future of San Jose and meeting with urban planners, looking at art and activism and how the murals have launched movements. They will be looking at civics in action and meeting with local politicians. And in the spring, we'll expand and go all over the world, travel for 3 weeks to look at important topics around renewable energy or the history of land use. As Mark said, a deep commitment to challenging our student, the right fit challenge, and that challenging rigorous academics should not in any way be in tension with joyful, meaningful learning. And our decision to have an advanced studies program is such that we can design courses, that our faculty will design independent courses that meet the intrinsic and exciting needs and desires of our students. These will run the gamut from climate justice to documentary making to multivariable calculus to machine learning. The extent of these courses will offer the breadth and depth that you will see, that students will see on a college campus. They will be dynamically prepared for that work. And if we want to believe deeply, and we do, about students making a difference in the world, our highest, most prestigious designation for students right now will be this Scott Center for Social Impact Fellowship. This will be the thing that, by naming it, it's the thing that we were going to inspire students to work toward. In every one of our disciplines, we will have social impact designated courses that are allowing, as a mathematician, as a historian, as a scientist, how do we think about social impact? If you take a certain number of these courses, design an individual or group project, and then present your social impact portfolio to a front of not just internal faculty, but community leaders, this will allow students to get become a fellow in this. And this is, I think we are really excited about this as a way to kind of be a clear statement of values. Again, athletics, we will be associate members of the CCS in year one, with hopefully a full membership in year two. We will be, this is our basketball court. It doesn't look like this yet. It will look like this soon. This is in the armory, but we will have volleyball and basketball. We plan to have an 8-man football team, a soccer team, cross-country team. We're looking at other opportunities based on student interest. And so starting as early as this spring, we'll be looking at, of our students coming in, what are you most excited about? And we will make sure that we have teams for them to play on. And they will play on it right from the start. This is not, I mean, in so many schools, students will be excited about putting on that jersey and playing for your team, but it takes a long time in a school that's 2,000. But starting in ninth grade, they will be leaders of this team. And this, from the ninth graders next year all the way to our current fifth graders who will join the high school to make it a full high school, their ability to grow this program, I'm so excited to see all of the work that they do. We also will have an amazing performing arts studio or program, just like we do here. Vanessa has already been looking at potential partnerships for us to be doing our performances in the Hammer Theater. So I'm just imagining next winter, you know, families coming in, going out for dinner in San Jose, having this great city experience, going to the Hammer Theater and seeing our ninth graders putting on a great show, and how real and exciting and electric that will feel. There are questions about moving from Los Gatos to San Jose, just to name them, around safety and transportation. So first of all, we will continue working with Jaffe, who we work with here, to make sure that we have security guards on campus, that there's a way to monitor students being in and out of the building. For ninth and 10th grade, it will be a closed campus, meaning like once they show up to campus, they will be there unless we take them off campus. And we're looking at how to open that up so that students are prepared for this in 11th and 12th grade. And we will intentionally build in sort of how to be smart in a city. That is a life skill that's critically important if we want to then put our kids into Columbia or NYU or any one of these urban campuses. Let's make sure they're ready for that now. We also want to make sure that as we think about, this is a school that is unique in the Bay Area. We have interests as far up as Oakland and San Francisco. How do we ensure that we can get every student to come to this campus that deserves an education like this? So just like we do in the lower middle school with the amazing work around transportation and buses and shuttles, we will be doing the same work. We imagine a lot of folks will be taking Caltrain or BART. We'll have shuttles coming from Los Gatos campus. It will be seamless, and we don't want that to ever be a barrier for folks to think about that as an experience. And lastly, you know, in terms of numbers, so people are asking, like, what will this be like? So the founding class, the ninth grade next year is going to have 60 students, and we imagine most, you know, about half of them will be coming externally and hopefully about half of them coming internally. It will be a new class. Over the next 4 years, we'll grow to about 300, about 75 kids in a class. But as we think about the size, using the city as a classroom, for students to use the San Jose State Library as our library, to be going and studying art all around the city, to be traveling around on the VTA, to be using the museums, to be doing internships and externships and community service all throughout the city, the size of it will feel enormous. And our students will feel confident in that size. And I just got off the phone with someone from another school who's looking at, how do we think about like cross-school partnerships so that the dynamic nature of kids, while they're being, while Hillbrook is their home, they'll be connected with students from all of the other schools in the area. Again, expanding, not shrinking. We've started a lot of review of the program that we've built with our own faculty. We invited faculty from other schools to come and look at it, and the feedback has been really great. And I think to end with, I want to make sure there's an open invitation to all of you. Melissa, who most of you know and will speak in a second, or after Charley, Melissa and I have been meeting with so many external families over on the other campus. There's an enormous amount of buzz. Tomorrow, I think it's Thursday, we have back-to-back from 8 to 5 meetings with families coming to say, like, how can I join this community? We want to give that opportunity for you, too. So if you want to learn more, join us. It would be great to do that over on the other campus so we can walk through the buildings, talk about the program, and ask any questions that you have. Our course catalog is out. It's online. We'll send it out to folks, but this QR code, we'll get you to there as well. We'll share this with you later. But the course catalog gets really into depth about all of the programming that we're doing. And lastly, about the team, super important is that it is a, you know, one school. So we have a bunch of folks, Ilsa and Gully and Annie, who's not here right now, who are going to be JK-12 roles to help create continuity between the campuses. We already, you know, as one school, Mark's clarity around this incredible venture has been so inspiring to everyone involved. But we've got a couple things that are going on right now. An AD search that has already launched. We are reviewing candidates later this week. According to the folks running the search, the interest has been enormous. And we will be having candidates coming to campus next month. And folks can meet them if interested. Launching probably early next week will be our 6 founding faculty positions. Interviews will start in October, candidates to campus in November, December, with the team hired by January. So you can all meet those folks, and I know that's going to be just a total dynamo team. And maybe most importantly for right now and in general is someone to help make sure that this process links together and creates security in building a dynamic high school program that prepares students for here, for college, and after. And I have been so excited to begin the working with Charley Burkly, and now you have a chance to hear from Charley.
So hello, it's so nice to see all of you coming in here this afternoon. And as Mark and Mike have said, it's been a wonderful week of really starting to think about how is the curriculum of the school going to come together and what is its future. And this is something that I have felt so confident in since the very first time I read a description of what this project is. And so over the next few minutes, I'd like to first give you a sense of what is my background, what have my experiences been. I've spent my entire career in education, but with the majority of that career doing precisely the work that I'll be doing at Hillbrook, which is serving in a college counseling capacity, plus reviewing applications as a college admissions officer. So I wanted to walk you through this with a few pictures. And so for those of you here in the room, I'll step aside a little bit. And so the first one here, this is just where I am now. And so the work that I'm doing now, as Mark said, we are in the middle of our college admissions season. More and more we're seeing deadlines come into the fall, into October, absolutely into November. And so when I get back to school tomorrow morning, I will be working with students on their essays. We'll be reviewing their applications. I might be doing a mock interview for a student. I'll be offering suggestions. And so just everywhere from that reflection to the practical specifics of what does it mean to not only submit an application, but to submit your very best application. So that's what I'm doing this time of year. It's lots of long checklists, but the culmination of all of these years of student growth and reflection to the point where they've identified the places where they are most excited to take that next step. And so where I have done college counseling is actually at a junior K through 12 school with two campuses. So there are similarities, certainly, with what Hillbrook is about to become. And the University School College Counseling Program is a top program. And here in this picture, on the left in the upper corner, is me this summer at a conference. AXIS is our professional organization of college counselors and independent schools. And every time I go to those conferences, I'm of course energized and excited to try new things and to continue in that spirit of innovation that we've definitely pursued at University School. But I'm also affirmed each time that we are doing things in the best possible way in support of our students, which is absolutely something that I can't wait to do here at Hillbrook as well. The work of college counseling is relational. And so I've had the tremendous opportunity, yes, to know different people in the field, in the admissions world, other college counselors, but most importantly, my students. And so in my work as a college counselor, I do all the things I said, but there are also so many other things that I do within the life of the school. And that's something that I have willingly taken on because it is so important, because I don't think I can be an excellent college counselor if I don't know students, I don't see their growth over time from the time, in my case, some of them were in seventh grade when I coached them on the track team. So in this picture here in the orange shirt, this is me serving in my student life capacity, getting to know 40 students across different grade levels. And working with advisors as they are working individually with these students. And so I've had the privilege of getting to know students in that way. I've also had the privilege too of serving as an assistant cross-country coach. So this was when our 2019 cross-country team was the first in our school's history, I believe, to make it to the state cross-country championship. And so getting to know students there was so different than seeing them in the halls of the school. So I've been able to tell those stories when I write my long narrative letters of recommendation. Then here, this is a student at the bottom. You can see we're actually at Princeton, New Jersey. It's one of the very best coffee shops that I highly recommend to all of you. They also serve hot chocolate like we had that day when it was, actually this is the ice cream shop next to the coffee shop. So, but I was meeting up with a student who I worked with in my very first year as a college counselor. And this student ended up going to Princeton, where I had worked previously in the admission office. And so while on a daily basis, I take what I've learned from working in a highly selective admissions environment and offer advice and guidance to students and families, this was where I was able to do it most directly because I had covered Africa as part of my territory. He was a student who had done the majority of his high school education in South Africa, so I just took that, applied it directly, was able to work with him in telling his story. And it's been incredible to stay in touch with him through the years. And in fact, he's in Southern California in a PhD program after a year of working in consulting. And it's just been such a privilege to see his journey, just as I imagine all of your students' journeys will be. And then just quickly giving you a sense of what came before this college admissions and college counseling life. This too informs what I do every day. And these are on either sides of the high school and college experience. And so I started my career in the upper right there as a middle school science teacher. And so this was one of my favorite projects I ever did. It was working with a group of seventh grade students who created a multilingual periodic table because I was working with English language learners in New York City. And so seeing them being able to own their science education but through a different lens is just one of the things that I am proudest of from those 2 years of teaching. And then after that, I went to the other side. So then after college, many students go to graduate school, and I worked in graduate school admissions. And I expect that many of your students will one day at least consider a career in business or might want to take a course or two. And I have lots of students who want to go that route currently. It's a very popular major. And I worked in MBA admissions, so I can offer that perspective saying, okay, well, you're going to do this in undergrad, but here are some things you might do, and then maybe you get your graduate degree. So I do feel that you know, spending this time right now talking through these different steps of what has brought me here today just can give a sense of the kind of advising, the kind of conversations that I can have with students and that I am just so excited to be able to have on a daily basis. So that is bullet point number one right there. That background, the introduction to who I am and what I hope to bring to all of you as the parents of future Hillbrook Upper School students. But then the second bullet here is what I think is probably on all of your minds, right? The college landscape feels like it's constantly changing. And there are things that I perceive as a college counselor as changing. You know, the things that I see that start to shift over time as I analyze the data and hear stories and in conversations with college admission counselors. But then there are the big ones that make national news, and those are certainly the ones that you see, you know, on your apps and in your newspapers, especially as what's happening in the college admissions process and what's happening on college campuses mirrors what's happening in the world. And we've all been through so much over the course of these past couple of years, and we, I think, know in this room some of the ways that the pandemic has impacted college and college admissions. Most obviously, I think all of you have heard of test optional, admissions policies. So whereas taking an ACT or taking an SAT has often been central to being a well-qualified college applicant, colleges have now, whether they liked it or not, shifted towards reviewing applicants without test scores. And for some, they've been so excited to finally have the freedom to do this. Some in these past couple of years have started to shift back because that was a priority for them. But that's certainly a change that we have seen. And then alongside those test optional admissions, it removes a barrier to applications. And then that is part of the story of the skyrocketing numbers of applications to colleges, particularly the most selective ones. And we are seeing a separation too, however. Some colleges are thriving and seeing more applicants than ever, whereas others are not doing as well, and some are even in danger of closing. So we're seeing that, I think, mirror a lot of what we see in our lives as well. So just wanted to mention a couple of things that you are probably well aware of here in the college admissions landscape. But on the flip side of that is that the kinds of changes that are being demanded of students and of applicants are those very qualities that Hillbrook students already possess at the middle school level and are going to continue to hone over the course of their high school careers. And so, for example, when a college was reviewing an application with a transcript but with no test score, they have to look at other parts of the application a little bit more closely. They're looking towards those narratives from teachers who know the students well. They're looking at the quality of writing from the students. They're also looking for students to be able to articulate what are their interests, what matters to them, what are they doing about this. And so putting all of that together, I think those are the reasons why Hillbrook's program stood out so much to me, because at the places that are taking in the most brilliant, accomplished, and students who have the greatest potential, they're the ones who have all of those qualities that that Hillbrook works so hard to develop in students. And so I think we, in all of these conversations, we want to talk about, you know, the changes and, you know, and how we're going to react, how we're monitoring them, how we're preparing students to be able to navigate it. But I think, too, you're well aware of it, as everyone in this room who works in some capacity with young people, that the changes are not just happening outside of your house, right? The changes are happening for every student. Their interests are changing. Their experiences are changing. Their outlook is changing. How are students talking about this? When they see changes in their city, they're seeing climate change. They're feeling empowered by social justice initiatives. These are changes. They're things they're seeing in the world. How are they reacting? How are they acting? And that, again, is something that our students will be so well equipped to navigate. And so then, just finally to close here with the final bullet point. So I think I've already spoken a little bit about the ways I see Hillbrook being able to uniquely prepare students for, yes, a process that's constantly changing, but also a process that I can say in my experience hasn't really changed so much in terms of what they are looking for in the very best students, every student who will be offering so much to their college campuses. And the reason I was grabbing my notebook before is because I could not have set it up better when we were at the MTC symposium. The other college admission counselor mentioned a few of the qualities that they look for in their students. So let me just pull that up really fast. And so I think these will resonate with all of you, so I'll close with this, is that of course with academics and rigorous academics being at the center of it all, but then beyond that, who are these students and what are they doing? And then what are their change maker qualities? Those were the exact words that were used up there on that panel. And how are students demonstrating community engagement and ability to engage with diversity? How have they developed a global perspective? How are they engaging with social justice? And how are they displaying creativity and innovation? So I don't think any of these things could do a better job of describing what our students in 5 years will be communicating to colleges as they're applying. So it's with so much excitement that I'm here with all of you today, and I am thrilled to be officially joining the Hillbrook community in January. And so I will hand it over now to Melissa to provide a few more details.
Hi, everyone. Thank you, Charley. What a gift to have you here with us this afternoon. I look forward to working together in January. So for those of you that I haven't met, I'm Melissa Bamberg, Director of Enrollment Management here at Hillbrook for the JK through 12. Just a plug for a couple of events that are upcoming. As Hillbrook families already, you get the benefit and the gift of not having to think about an upper school choice. If you guys want to come to Hillbrook Upper School, our students will automatically matriculate to the upper school, but an open invitation to all middle school families, if your family chooses to do this year or in future years, come to any of our in-person or virtual admissions events just to learn a little bit more about the program, the faculty. We'll do a deeper college counseling dive in January when Charley comes onto campus officially. We are doing a number of events in person, 2 Saturdays this fall and 1 evening in the winter, for you to come and get a look at the campus, hear from some administrators. For anyone that can't attend any of these but still wants to come for a tour or a visit, please reach out to Mike, myself, to Mark. We are happy to walk your family around the campus, talk a little bit more about the program, and answer any of your family's individual questions. In addition, We have a number of virtual information sessions about different upper school focuses. Starting next Thursday on the 29th, we're going to have a deep dive into the academic program at the upper school. All of this information is going to be shared to eighth grade families through Eden's high school admissions spreadsheet, and then for all other families through Hillbrook Happenings, there'll be a link to register and get webinar links for all of this information as well. But please, for these events, it'll be webinar style, so very low stakes. Turn it on while you guys are eating dinner, putting your kids to bed, just hanging out at home to listen in as much as you'd like. And I want to leave some room for questions. Mike, do you want to take over and take some questions? Oh, okay.
This is for all four of us. Curious to know if there are things you'd like to hear more about. Core value number two, be curious. Not a weird question. I mean, I'll answer a little bit, and Mark, if you want to jump in, or Charlie or Melissa. I mean, the wheels in my head are always turning,
right.
Pretty fast.
And I'm sorry, parents, because my kid is only in sixth grade.
No,
so
but it's.
You have a better, you know.
So the I mean, there is an obvious container for the city as classroom, which is those immersive. So these 3 week courses that are happening at the end of each semester. So by design. These will be interdisciplinary opportunities to examine complex problems. And we're preparing students to do that work of there is no easy answer. How do we navigate between possible choices of how to think through complex issues in the world? Additionally, with our 80-minute blocks, these longer blocks mean that within the curriculum, within each courses, starting as early as ninth grade, we will be intentionally designing our academic courses to find integration points within the city. And so whether it's using some data analysis in a math class or looking at kind of history and our world history class, comparing like kind of maybe one global city in San Jose and doing a compare and contrast between them, these opportunities exist there. Using co-curricular time after school, I strongly imagine we'll have some sort of community service group that's doing some work. And then the exciting thing, which I didn't talk about, is we're really thinking about 9th and 10th grade as an opportunity to build core skills. The knowledge framework that will allow students to ask dangerous, in a positive way, dangerous and important questions. And then in 11th and 12th grade, look for ways to kind of liberate within our schedule opportunities for students to go about answering those questions. And engaging others in the answering of those questions. And so we will be using a hybrid model in 11th to 12th grade that leverages some of the skills that we all learned during the pandemic about how do we deliver content and engage asynchronously so that there'll be increased opportunities, potentially even the length of an entire day in the 11th to 12th grade year where students are going out and working in internships, working in community service projects, leading and engaging in a social impact project of their own. And so following the curiosities of each student and creating those opportunities for authentic real-world learning that is incredibly complex, and not to jump over to Charley on this, but like for a student to be able to tell that story and how they got to that story and how they navigated sort of an enduring task of a long-term project, both the emotional endurance and the intellectual endurance that requires. I mean, talk about uniquely preparing kids and a compelling case for why they are going to step immediately onto a college campus and know what to do. Any additions?
This is such a great question. And you know, we chose San Jose very intentionally, right, to be in downtown San Jose. So just two quick add-ons. I think one is, you know, we will have a Reach Beyond Scholars program, which will be 10 students, all who will be, you know, first generation to go to college students. So, you know, there's a real commitment as a school to have, you know, so up to, you know, 40 students out of a population of 300 will be Reach Beyond Scholars. But also we really want to be part of San Jose. And one of the things that's been so exciting, just spending, you know, a handful of us have been spending time down there this summer, is the ways that groups have been reaching out to us to invite us over to, you know, check out their different spaces and learn about them. And we are entering, recognizing that we're not coming to save San Jose. Like, we're coming to be part of San Jose, and we're just really excited about the opportunity. I think right now we have a lot of questions, and we don't, you know, we're new. So, yeah, thanks for asking that question. Other questions? Yeah.
Charley, can I answer just a brief piece of this, and then? Yeah. So the question is, how will we prepare students when so much of a narrative is around taking as many AP classes as possible and honors courses? Is that? Let me share just one thing, and then you're going to answer this much more clearly than I. We have done our research, and the school has done its research, and we are students of independent schools, and if you look at the best progressive independent schools across the country, in San Francisco, in Seattle, in New York, these schools, almost all of them got rid of APs over a decade ago, and because it felt too constraining. The opportunity to teach both at the level of AP courses, but actually much further, and also to make sure that we're offering the courses that are of urgency in terms of what are the things that we need to be learning about, as well as of interest. What are the things that kids are most curious about? And so we are among a large group of students, or a large group of schools that are offering an advanced studies track, and these schools are all putting kids into the top universities. But maybe you could talk about like the college profile and how people look at an individual school.
Yeah, and I can say that over, it would be 8 years ago when I was first, you know, reviewing applications for undergraduate admissions, even then I'm almost picturing myself at my desk chair looking at a transcript of a school that doesn't offer APs and not even batting an eye, because the way that I'm looking at that transcript is asking the question, is this student taking the most rigorous course load available to them? And as you know, if you have older children and start visiting colleges, it's completely true when you hear those words, which are usually said in that exact same way, because we all talk the same. But that is truly what colleges are looking for. But the question then is, how do they know what the most rigorous course load available is? And in many, if not most schools, you know, APs still are around, right? Because it's a known it's a known course path. There's a lot of familiarity, and it has been a way that high schools have gone for many years. But it is well known on the college side that there are schools like Hillbrook that are truly going beyond the bounds of the AP curriculum. And so the way that comes across from high schools, and I was just working on our school profile so I could say this with it all very clear in my mind, is that there is usually about a 2-page school profile that highlights the school and describes, you know, the really important aspects of that institution. And then talks about what is the most rigorous course load. It offers a course list that designates what those courses are. And so then, putting all of that together, it's the college's job to look at each student in the context of their high school, and in that way, our students will be reviewed by colleges.
Charlie, I guess the question's for you. So historically, Eden's done a great job, like our kids from here, when they went to high school, the high schools knew what was coming out of Hillbrook, because it's been there long enough. But you, it's gonna be brand new class, Hillbrook High School is not unheard of. How are you gonna create that relationship or make them aware of what to expect?
Yeah.
I mean, brand new school, they don't know. I mean, they want academics still. They're not gonna bring kids in who are not capable. So how are you gonna create that awareness
between
the desirable schools
to
create a channel to join?
Yeah. So the question here was asking about, you know, Hillbrook being a new school, and there are lots of other high schools that we know well that colleges also know well, because they've received applications from these places over the course of not just decades, but sometimes even longer. And then how does Hillbrook establish ourselves in that particular scenario? And you're absolutely right that's what I'm here, you know, before the school even officially starts next summer, spreading the word. And I'm, of course, not the only one doing that. But I am the person who is most often interacting with college admission officers, other college counselors, and that's already started. Like, I was just the picture from that conference, I was talking to all the other college counselors when I've been meeting with the college admission reps to my current school, and I've built relationships, and I'm telling them about what's gonna happen for their colleague who's the regional rep in Northern California. What are they going to encounter in a few years? And so it absolutely is building upon the many, many relationships that I've developed over time, and just generating that excitement, yes, that's part of it. But then conveying the important details and information, that is going to come through in a school profile, but it is also going to come through picking up the phone and welcoming college admission officers to our campus. I think trying to host events in the college admission space on our campus so that there is that familiarity and excitement that continues. So it's a combination of, you know, raising awareness and then backing it up with what has already been established as an outstanding program. Anything else to add?
Another shameless plug for going to our webinars. One of them on October 20th, I think, is gonna be particularly relevant for some of the concerns around what does it mean to start or be a founding family. And all of these webinars will be about Hillbrook, but this one, because we haven't had a founding family in a long time, 87 years, we're drawing on a neighboring school and some of the founding students and families. So I had the chance of working at Nueva from its start of starting a high school. And all of these same concerns were at play there too. And there will be about 7 students and 4 parents who are joining to talk about sort of how they sort of wrestled with the risk of joining something new and some of the considerations that they had. And at risk of comparing two schools, because the schools are different, but I think worth sharing, it was a beautiful first year, second year, when all of a sudden we had juniors, things got a little scary, and when our kids started applying, this is that first time of applying to colleges, we were all nervous, like, how are they gonna do? And we put 15 kids into Stanford, a couple kids into Harvard, Princeton, Yale. Not that it should all be about these top-tier schools, but we did incredibly well. And we also met the needs of each kid. Kids were going into lots of schools that were right fit for them. And the reason, and we were hearing this from the admissions side, the reason why we did so well is they said the unique skills that our students developed by co-creating a school. And that's what they're gonna do. They will be part of co-creating, they will build culture, they will launch clubs, they will start teams. The leadership skills that they will develop uniquely in these first couple of years is not missed on the college side. So will they be prepared for college better than any other opportunity, both because of the program, but also because of this singular circumstance of timing? It's getting close to three. I like to do this, and I don't know about you all, so we're doing this real time. I think it's sometimes nice, some questions that you may have that you may not want to ask in person or in a large group. We'll stick around if you want to chat more. We also want to respect your time. Thank you so much for coming. We're like so excited about this next 4 years, 5 years, and into the future beyond that, and excited for you to be on that journey with us. And once again, to extend that invitation to learn more with us, come down, come over to San Jose, walk around, ask your questions, because we want this to be a dynamic creation alongside each of you. Thanks so much.